Background music and ambience brought to you in part by Midnight Syndicate. Music for the imagination and the perfect musical accompaniment for the Dungeons & Dragons role-playing game.
The leader of Gagmi is dead. The guild as a whole has been dealt a critical blow. The world trembles as portal magic tears at the fabric of reality. Tim and Terry must find the Stable One in order to end the threat from the other realms. And Master Duché has finally acquired the means to conquer and rule this realm as a god. Now, prepare yourselves for the culmination of Campaign 1 as they seek resolution of a fool's quest.
So, you get into Rilias, you come into town, you can see that the farmhouses that had been burned down your last trip through here have been being rebuilt. They're in the process of being rebuilt right now as you're walking down the road. So you can see the town is starting to come back to life and trying to rebuild from the ashes from Duché's men. And
heard burn them down again.
Malphaedor will probably start feeling a little nostalgic, considering that this is the town that he acquired Macy in.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Macy. Shit. Well, now I'm fucking sad.
But she doesn't have any more ties here.
I mean, she didn't have any more ties in the real world either. Ingvald's entire intention is going to be going to Tim and Terry's mom's house before they get there, of course.
Yeah, okay. I kind of figured that.
So, I'm going right to the middle of the city right now.
In fact, I will nudge Tim and say, "You know he's going to go after your mom, right?"
Tim's like, "I don't want to hear this."
Oh yeah,
already he's long got, gone.
Bad,
like this
he's
conversation. Bad. This conversation is way too late. I'm already on my way.
This is awful.
Speaking of, where are you?
So you see the city, and Ingvald goes running forward on his
sprinting,
his little dwarven legs just like waddling.
I'm coming, run, Samantha, Ingvald,
like a really fast duck.
I got like a 35 feet per
crazy dwarven monk.
A beer mug in one hand.
Here I come, man.
I'm sure I have a beer for dexterity. Go, I can probably dash. I don't know. I'm going to fucking leave me alone.
All right, so you guys get into Rilias, and you head to Samantha's house. And you get there. It's just the way you remembered it from when you guys fried the wood off the windows. And she opens the door and says, "Ingvald, welcome back."
She seemed kind of leery about it. Like, "Oh, it's Ingvald."
She's wearing like a shawl, you know, and she tightens it over her bosom. She like closes it up, crosses her arms. "Hi, how you doing?"
"This is my no-no square."
"It's fine, I have beer."
It's the Roman red.
I
now you have to flirt with Nick.
Oh, hell no.
No.
Roll play.
Oh, sorry. Get to. My bad. I misspoke.
Like, it's not like the first time.
We've all done it.
I'll tell you the first time in game. First time out of game. I politely let her know that the rest are falling behind me shortly. And invite myself inside.
So you come in and you see that there is another halfling in the house with her.
I don't like that at
Ooh,
all.
Competition.
I kindly stab the halfling.
kindly, though, so it's cool. You know, he doesn't mind it.
It's like a casual.
Hi, how you doing? Oh, sorry about that.
Oh. I slipped, fell, stabbed you.
I gestured casually. Yeah, gotcha.
The halfling is a female. Jesus, guys.
This ass. And that's not. Now he's into it. That. I mean,
the halfling is younger and looks very similar to Tim and Terry. And Samantha says, Ingvald, I'd like to introduce you to my daughter, Tiana.
Fair point. Ingvald just, hello, and my name is Ingvald Porter Altbeer. I am a brewer and former savior of the city.
And I'm going to bang your mom.
Don't say that yet.
I'm going to be your new daddy.
Tiana says,
we were just about to have tea. Would you care to join us?
I prefer a beer, but I'd love to sit over a tea as well.
All right. One beer with tea on the side.
I do put the tea in my beer. Call that
great,
a
great
call
way to
that
ruin
a shandy,
both
boys.
Drinks.
Fuck you.
All right. So you do that for whatever reason, and
because I'm a monster.
Yeah, I agree. And a few moments later, the rest of the party comes rolling into view, and they can see you in the house with Samantha. The door was left wide open because you said there were more people coming, so she left it open. Yeah, and so you guys are there.
Cool.
I wink at Tim and Terry as I walk in the door.
Tim just shakes his head no, and Terry is oblivious. So
good.
You have to call them son from now on.
I will after we leave.
Samantha sees you guys coming.
Sort
she's
of
like,
adopt them in a fatherly manner.
Come on in, come on in. She's like, Tim, Terry. She comes down the stairs and gives the boys a hug and, you know, one in each arm. She's like, I missed you so much. I've heard that you've been doing wonderful things and such great exploits in your travels and your journeys. Come in, come in, come in. And she brings the boys in. And she goes to the kitchen to start making them some lunch, because that's what she does.
Moms do.
More Hot Pockets.
That's what moms do.
Yeah.
Opening that can of Alpo. Where, corgis?
With some bread on a sandwich. She cuts the crust off.
She Alpo cuts the sandwich.
Crust off. just kibbles between two slices of bread. Oh, man. Okay.
Peanut butter and kibble.
Nope.
So Tim and Terry walk into the door and they're like looking around, and then Terry sees Tiana and says, that's her. That's the stable one. That's the one I was talking about.
Really?
Yes.
It just got a lot easier.
Look over. Oh, shit.
Well, all right. Well, we just figured out how to save the world. Not.
Did we? I still don't know what to do.
Yeah, we don't either.
Okay, great. Well, now what?
So, I suggest that we sit down as a group and discuss everything that's been going on. Get everybody up to speed and pose this all to Tiana and see what she makes of it.
Okay.
Considering that, you know, Terry considers her the stable one, but we don't know what the fuck that means.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Let's do it. And so Terry goes in and awkwardly sits down at his own kitchen table and awkwardly stares at his sister that he did not know he had. After a few moments, Samantha comes out of the kitchen. She says, here's some kibble pancakes that I made for you guys. It's chocolate chips and and puppy chow.
What the fuck?
And she says, I guess I've got some explaining to do.
I'll explain.
Okay, explain.
A long time ago, before any of you were born, a person came to me. She had said that there would be three children that I would find along my journey, and these three children would need my help. And I soon, about a year later, found Tiana and two younger babies. And Tiana was there with me, or Tiana came to me and needed my help, and so I brought them all into my home. So I'm not actually the mother of Tim, Terry, or Tiana. And dun, dun, dun. From what I can see,
Tim, well, this makes us way less sexy. Yeah. I'm out.
And for that reason, I'm out.
Tim and Terry are half brothers, that is true. And Tiana is the older sister. I don't know who their parents are, though. Tiana really doesn't remember much either from that age.
So if they're if they're half brothers, is she full sibling to one of the two, or is she a third half?
She is a full sibling to one of the two. I think to Terry. But yeah, that's, yeah. Yep, so she came here, and then as she got older, a little bit older, Tiana decided to move and go find her own way. And so she left. And that was when the boys were still very young, like toddlers. So they didn't remember her, and I didn't talk about her. The person who told me that these children would come here told me not to talk about her after she left. I didn't understand why. But, alas, here we are, and she's back, and you are all connected, and I believe the person that is setting all this up knows how you guys might be able to stop whatever it is that you're supposed to stop.
Just on a whim, was that person's name Magno Odd?
No.
Do you remember their name?
Yeah. Her name is Abigail.
There's a coincidence.
And she is one of the first people.
We know where we're going now.
Yeah, next stop.
I totally remember that.
Abigail the Wanderer from Seaforge.
That one I actually did remember. It was supposed to be sarcastic. I actually had that one.
Okay. Okay. So, Tiana, would you be willing to travel with us and help us to heal whatever is tearing this land apart?
Tiana says,
I don't know about healing what's tearing this world apart, but I will protect my little brothers.
That's enough for me.
Yeah.
She'll probably ask your mother.
I mean, they're all old. They're all adults.
They're adults.
Still a mom. I don't know.
Yeah, but they're like little kids. Like,
I'm trying to lay her mom.
She's not my real mom.
You're not my real mom.
You're not my mom. Fuck you.
Curious about that lineage now. Maybe Abigail has some more insight on that.
They're all Thorkillin's kids.
Thorkillin and Abigail.
All fucky.
Okay.
Ingvald has nothing.
Any other business in Rilias other than...
I already shopped it out last time I was here.
Actually, Malphaedor will... if I remember that right, there's a small temple area to the 12.
Yep.
I will go there in the evening before, while we're... after we're done visiting, and just give a little offering at the altar of the many-faced god.
Oh, okay.
In remembrance and of one of his servants.
Okay.
So this whole episode is just going to have sad music behind it the whole time.
Well, just off and on.
Sad music, and then William dropping his fucking dice and his keys slamming into the
chair. That's in the outtakes.
That's actually not a bad theory that these three are the sons of Abigail and
Thorkillin.
Yeah. Thorkillin.
Hey, man.
Hey.
I try sometimes. I'm going to help.
Second generation, first ones.
Herds. It's your who Thor.
Who knows? We'll figure it out.
Okay.
Or maybe we just...
Is it right? I don't know.
And he's like, ah, look, frustrated. Oh, they're so close. They're so close.
All right. You guys did want... You had also wanted to take a look around and see if you had any leads to find out where Duche's people were coming from or going to, or...
I'll let them do that while I'm visiting the temple area.
Okay. Ingvald's going to tour the city.
I do want to ask Samantha. Your last name is Brokenmirror, and you gave it to them when you... for lack of a better term, adopted them? Or did they come to you as broken mirrors? Because...
Looks over at the tablet. Oh, fuck.
I'm doing a family tree over here with these guys.
She says, my last name is Hobbleleg.
Okay.
Hobbleleg?
Yeah, that's Tim's last name.
Okay.
So Tiana and... Terry are broken mirror.
Okay. And Tim's half broken mirror.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right. What were you going to do, Ingvald?
I am going to look, like, tour the city looking for signs of portals and also signs of just Duche's men being around.
Okay. Roll an investigation.
15.
Okay, so that's going to do it, actually, because that will, I mean, so you walk around, and you meander through the town looking at people, and you do see a guy who's cutting wood, and on his arm, he's got his sleeves rolled up while he's chopping wood, but you see a tattoo of an upside-down martini glass with no base. And you remember that to be Whisper's tattoo.
Is that just called a triangle?
Well, then it's a triangle with a line coming up out of the top.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
I don't know if you remember, I tried saying it that way before, and you guys couldn't grasp the concept. So I said it was an upside-down martini glass with no base, and then you guys could wrap your head around that.
I don't really that shit. It seems like you said a triangle with a line, and I feel like I would have gotten that.
Dan Brown, we're not.
We did this. We did this whole bit.
just in reverse, a little triangle of the line. Heard.
So the line comes up into the bottom of the triangle, or?
Is it an umbrella, or is it?
You know we're doing this on purpose, right?
Yeah, I hate it.
The thing is, he doesn't know we're doing this on purpose.
And that's season 5, folks.
Season 5.
Ba-dum-bum-ba-dum-bum. Nico's and sued done. Again. oh no!
That so you was, see the guy chopping wood. What do you want to do?
I need a reminder of what that symbol means.
Is he? It means he's a recruit of Whispers. He's okay, an agent of Whispers.
That's what I thought. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Cool. So I am going to approach.
Okay.
At first, casually, like, kind of start a conversation with, wow, chopping wood this time of year, just kind of. Start the conversation because it's middle of summer, I believe, right? In
spring.
It's
spring.
Late spring.
Spring,
yeah. And they live next to the ocean, so, yeah, so it's kind of chilly.
Like chopping. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
It can get breezy.
No, fuck them. We start a conversation with like a chopping wood this time of year kind of intro into it.
Yeah. Got to keep the house warm.
Warm, newer settler out this way?
Yeah.
Time. Not used to the weather, I assume?
No, yeah. I'm from a warmer climate, closer to the Apache. Closer to the whatever desert. I can't think.
Charvosi.
Charvosi, thank you. Closer to the Charvosi Desert.
Gotcha. What brought you out all the way here?
I came out to meet some other friends, and they were no longer here by the time I got here, so I just thought I would take up residence. Met a nice lady and decided to retire from soldiering and make a home here.
Gotcha. I'm at this point probably going to sit shortly behind him.
Okay.
And bring up like about this time last year, I assume is when they invaded.
Yeah. Yeah.
Awesome. And by the time he turns around, I'll have a sword already at his throat.
Ooh. Jeez. Well, it's not good to chop wood with a sword, friend. Should use the axe.
Or mace, I guess, by his throat. I don't have a sword. I forgot. But either way.
Oh, yeah, you got the ice mace, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're already chilling his throat. About this time last year?
Yeah.
about this time last year. Yep.
Where might your boss still be hiding? Or any of your friends that were here?
Oh, my boss is dead, I'm pretty sure. The guy that sent me down here, his name was Whispers.
Gotcha. And his boss?
His boss is a guy named Duché.
Where might he be hiding?
I don't know where he's hiding, but I know where he recruited me from.
That's good enough for me.
Okay.
And good enough for your life.
Alright. Just walk around threatening random people.
Random people don't have that tattoo, sir.
I mean, I'm a random person, I've got the tattoo, but, I mean, you're the guy with the cold mace, so, whatever. I met him up in Sormi. It's, near Amachi. It's in the Charvosi Desert. They, recruited us, and then I trained, at Maraxi's Tower.
Long since destroyed that. It's not very helpful. Oh, I didn't destroy it, I guess we...
You cleared it of all the monsters?
Cleared it.
Killed Whispers. Mm-hmm.
Killed Whispers.
Yeah. Took a basement back.
Ooh.
Ooh. We did the same thing with Mikey.
That's fair. That's not better, actually.
He's hanging in your bar.
That's worse.
To be fair, not fair.
You named your bar after him.
Worse. But I will drop the mace to my side. Anything else you'd like to say? Anything else? Anything information you might have?
If you're looking for Duché's guys, I mean, Maraxi's Tower was kind of where they headquartered everything. So, I mean, if you've already been there, then I don't know much else there. I would have to say, check it out.
I will start to walk away at that point in time and look back. You should get that tattoo covered.
Yeah,
maybe something a little bit more discreet.
Yeah, maybe I'll get it.
Put a line across the top, it'll look like a martini glass.
Fill it in, look like a Triforce.
Just a pyramid with a line. Fuck it, I don't care.
I'll do that.
For the
thank
circle.
You.
For the...
No, I'll keep touring the city. I'm sure I won't find anything, but I'll tour the city for any more potential signs.
Yeah, you don't find anyone else. You just find him who... sent you back to Maraxi's Tower.
Gotcha. I come back and tell the crew about maybe retouring Maraxi's Tower is the best option for right now.
Mm-hmm.
But that's about all I have.
Only you guys had a portal that connected you from Cheddar. Right,
that'd be super handy, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oops.
Oh well.
Mm-hmm. All right.
That's some horrible world design.
So what do you guys? Anything else for the evening, or...
Yes, I'm going to offer Tim and Terry's mom a beer.
Oof.
And everyone else.
Everyone drinks your beer.
I'm going to recommend to Samantha that she not drink the beer.
Oh, all right. Let's see.
It's for your own good.
I'm not there.
Don't.
I didn't. I would.
Don't
never,
let him get you drunk.
I would never roofie anyone.
We didn't. I didn't say you would.
Jesus. So Samantha takes a couple sips, but she rolled well and takes Sir Thaddeus's advice. And so she slow rolls the drinks and notices everybody else get smashed off the first beer.
Heard. Ingvald's not smashed yet because Ingvald
is an alcoholic.
Incorrect. I'm level 12. I'm immune to all poisons. Fuck you. It's because of that, not my constant drinking. And I'm definitely going to hit on Tim and Terry's mom.
All right, make your charisma check. We'll see what happens when it fades to black.
Eat my ass, 23. Nat 20.
Jesus. All right,
for
so
reference, there it is. Eat my ass. Mike, I'm gonna fuck Tim and Terry's mom.
Mike,
no, you just successfully flirted with her. That's all that means.
Fuck you, Nat.
You know what? She's into it. She likes the short guys, and it's been a while since she's knocked boots. So
come here, cutie. Hey, come here.
So Mike, it's
been four seasons getting ready for this
up,
shit.
Cue up the romantic lovemaking music, and we're gonna fade to black with Ingvald fulfilling his lifelong dream.
End of episode one. Two, ready for a beer break. Whoop.
Actually, I am ready for a beer break.
God damn.
Thank you so much for listening. We need to take a quick moment to flip it on over to the B-side, so sit tight and relax. A Fool's Quest will be right back.
Microphones and Monsters is a Cthulhu D&D actual play with a balance of horror, mystery, and comedy. Our story begins in a 1920s Magitek noir setting. We follow the story of Alistair.
That power is very much something that I need, and I don't want that to stop.
Victor.
I don't think I want to help you.
And Julian.
It's burning. What happened here can't see the light of day.
As they come face to face with eldritch horrors.
I don't think you could ever stop me.
And try not to fall into madness. Go to microphonesandmonsters.com or listen wherever podcasts are found.
Thank you all for listening to A Fool's Quest. As an additional way to connect with us and to help support the show, you can become a member of the official Creative Typo Patreon. Membership has its privileges and includes ad-free episodes, early access to new episodes, access to art, music, and lore, merchandise giveaways, Discord perks and status, special bonus episodes, and behind-the-scenes content you won't get anywhere else. And with several amazing podcasts under Creative Typo's umbrella, you have access to all of our shows with only a single membership. Currently, all proceeds will be reinvested right back into our shows, bringing you even more of the quality content we've enjoyed sharing with you. And there's plenty more on the way. And if Patreon just isn't your thing, no worries. You can continue to enjoy all of our shows just as you have been. Patreon is completely a bonus for those who would directly like to support the show and connect with the cast. To check out the Patreon details, including subscription tiers and benefits, just go to patreon.com/creativetypo or follow the link at our homepage at afoolsquest.com. And remember, stay safe, we love you all, and most importantly, stay foolish.
Hi, excursionist. I'm Nari. Do you know that stories have a way of taking you into a different world? Why don't you join me at the Into the Night Anthology podcast? We present you with bite-sized stories that make you question what you thought you knew.
I may have something that would interest you. Everything gets old. So someday, as long as it's cared for, any item will become an antique. That includes you and me. And sometimes terrify you with what you didn't.
What's happening? This can't be real.
You can see us, but you are powerless to stop us.
Bring a friend along when you find us on your favorite podcast directory, and make sure to follow us on Twitter at Into the Night Pod so you never miss an episode. Remember, you should never wander these twisted paths alone. In fact, look, the first path is just ahead. Are you ready? Follow me.
Oh yeah, the flip side is spinning and the villains are chilling. Let's get back into it on A Fool's Quest.
Now, let's join the drow rogue Ayda, the gladiator bard Francis the Lion, and the rogue warlock Hesh von Eggars as they conspire together to thwart the progress of those gagmy fools. Beware, there be villains here.
So, you make your way along
away.
The outskirts of the desert, following the path, and you travel for a couple days. Like I said, the road's not super easy terrain, but you do follow a path that you can get. And it stops short. You stop short when you come into view of Maraxi's Tower, which you can see it jutting up into the sky. Now, Maraxi's Tower is the tower that the heroes went into in Season 2 where they fought Whispers.
They killed the zoo and, of innocent creatures.
Yep. And, but you stop short because you notice that the ground is all torn away there. Now, there do appear to be bridges that have been created, makeshift bridges. So wood from the surrounding forested areas, rope, and bone seems to be put together. And you can see some of these orcish, hideous creatures. They're huge creatures. Well, not like huge as far as the game is considered, but compared to orcs, they're bigger than your average orc. And they have like deformed faces, deformed arms. They're, you know, they might have one regular arm, one hideously deformed arm, and then, you know, one hideously deformed leg, and the other leg is like an athlete runner's leg. It's very foxy. And, so these are the orcs that you can see from a distance that are kind of just making busy work of the area around them and building up some kind of fortified defenses of this area.
All right. I think we should scout and see if we can determine a hierarchy to see who seems to be in charge of these.
And then challenge him to single combat.
Right. For you to do that, you do that part. And then I'll cheer you on.
Single combat is my specialty.
Yeah. Diplomacy's mine. I'm pretty good. Pretty good at it, so I hear. And I think theft and burning shit down is Ada's.
Not intentionally.
Alright, well, if it comes to it, we can unintentionally have you go and burn this place even more to the ground. Do we need anything from here? Weren't we supposed to meet Keen Mind?
Yep.
My notes don't show, like, why we were going to Maraxi's. I thought that we were going to meet...
We have to try to gain control of the portal.
Got you. Thank you.
Maraxi's Tower.
I must have forgot to write that down. Okay. So, how do we want to do this then? Do we want to annihilate them, or would we like to try diplomacy first?
If we annihilate them, that's just going to alert the city guard.
Well, I mean, they're orcs, right?
Yeah. Like, but this is like right outside Maraxi's Tower, pretty much.
Yeah.
And then it's basically like a horde of orcs.
Yeah. Yeah. Which you don't see any normal like people. You only see orcs now.
Right. This is like a tribe of orcs versus like...
Maraxi's Tower was inhabited by people from Cheddar. There was guards from Cheddar and there were Gagmi people that were here. After Whispers had fallen, a bunch of soldiers and recruits and stuff moved into Maraxi's Tower to take it over. So none of them are visible, though.
Yeah. Can I... What's the likelihood, and I say this out loud, what's the likelihood that those are the people...
You mean the city guard?
And that the rift has now made them into orgasms. Tiny, tiny orgasms.
I think the likelihood of that is fairly low. My guess is these creatures came through the rift.
Scientifically speaking, I agree with you because I have no scientific education.
And Francis did go to school at the Miskatonic University.
I did not. So I guess I reiterate my point. my question rather. Do we try to talk our way or stab our way? All right. Because from what I understand, those are the only two options we're allowed to do.
How many of them are there?
Well, we could also try to sneak.
From what
them,
you can see, there's at least 30 or 40 milling about outside.
Sneaking doesn't get us control of the rift.
How about
though?
We try to catch one on a pee break and then see what we can get out of them before we just charge in there. Well, how many of them? There's four of us because Sebastian is with us. So there's only four of us. I mean, I like our odds too, but we don't know exactly what we're getting into because I've never seen these fuckers before.
Yeah.
So I think catching one off guard and interrogation might be
well, the
smartest
thing. Well, I don't
speak
Orcish. Do either of you speak Orcish?
I do not.
Sebastian might.
I speak a gobbledygook.
Well, the character.
A dream speak, a gobbledygook of the deep ones from the void, but I don't think that really helps. Some call it abyssal, but I like gobbledygook.
I've got common, elvish, and thieves can't.
Got common and giant.
I have.
All right, I'm gonna
spells.
Wait.
Woo! We could kill one, and then I could use a speak with dead scroll, which I got a while ago. And if they're able to speak a language, then we can communicate with it. But we have 5 questions before it expires.
I think, waiting for a lone orc and accosting it away from the rest of the orc chasm is probably our best bet. We'll try peaceful communication first, but if that doesn't work, then the speak with dead may.
Alright. I can lure one away. I'm sure of it.
A child.
What?
A young one.
I don't know.
Not like a baby, but like 10, 12 years old. You
this
know.
Is why I don't leave you alone Adolescent. With Carlos anymore, if you're wondering.
Oh. Just so you know, he sneaks away at night. I'm not going to tell you what we do.
The corpse knows only what it knew in life, including the languages it knew.
I hate this.
A young one might know other languages, though.
Why?
We don't know where they're from.
So
is it like an immigrant? immigrant parents come and their kids know the language better than they do?
Yeah. Sure, why not? Kool-Aid man's in this world. Why not? You know, immigrating orcs.
Okay. All right, then. I guess I'm gonna go down and try and make a friend.
In your mech suit?
What? No, obviously not. That's ridiculous.
Who fucking knows with you?
Hey, Carlos, why don't you hold on to this for me?
He's trapped underneath it. So they're trying to lift it off.
You have to attune to it for it to move for you, right?
Yeah, with the retinal scan.
Yeah, so he basically just sits in there, like leaving a dog in the car, but with the window down.
He's pretending to drive.
He pretty much automatically attunes to it because he's got so many eyeballs, it could not scan him. It must
all it's doing is scanning.
Scanning. Each eyeball is scanning, so it's just attuning him time after time.
Are you going, Carlos, too?
Time after time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the plan here is to go down and get a otherworldly orc singled out.
Yep.
And then murder him.
No.
Or just capture him.
Yes.
Okay.
Talk with.
Hold on.
Hopefully lure him away from the crowd. No animosity. Communication first, if possible. And then slit this throat if we have to. I'm down for whatever, but let's be diplomatic.
Concentration up to an hour. I'm going to cast Mislead on myself. Which makes me invisible and summons an illusory double, which I can use its senses and speak through it if I choose to. And I'm going to send that illusory double down.
Okay.
I'm going to get back in the mech suit then.
Be prepared, he says. Oh, we'll be prepared. For what?
Yeah, I'm going to send it down and approach the smallest group of the orcs that I can see, but not approach too closely. Stay maybe, 40 or 50 feet away and just stop and give them a wave. The double.
We're like up on the ravine, right?
I'm in some trees.
Well, so you are, you are
oh,
up.
Oh, no, I found a tree.
You are up in on top of the cliff is the path that you took. So you're not down in the actual chasm, the orc chasm. But there is a big circle that goes around Maraxi's tower that you're going to have to cross these newly created bridges that the orcs have just to be able to get to the tower. So, okay. Yes, so you are up above still. They're at ground level with you, but they are in between you and the bridges, which is between you and the tower.
Oh, they're not down in the orc chasm?
Some of them are.
Some of them are, but there's some up on the top.
But there's some up on the top, too.
Okay, so we don't have to send them down anywhere. I'll just send them, yeah.
So you send them to where the orcs are, right?
Yeah, stop okay. Maybe 50 feet away or so and have them just give a wave. And say, hello there.
And one of them lets out a giant roar and says,
Rosky Flay on, young guy.
And then chucks a dart at your illusory double.
I'm pretty sure Tony kept saying devil, so that's what it is to me.
Devil.
It's a devil. Also, can Hesh turn into Aladdin inside the Hesh suit? And then have.
Is it concentration to turn into something else?
No, it's masking many faces.
Because you can't have a concentration spell inside the.
True.
So if it's not a concentration, then yeah, you can do whatever the fuck you want. I don't give a shit.
Action duration 1 hour, self no concentration. Anyways, so Carlos can turn into. A poo. And just hang out at the top of the trees. Because we are in the forest, right? You said that was up by the forested area?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, hang out at the top of the trees and be my eyes and ears. So I'm just going to be, like, in the mech suit, huddled down in the base of the trees, in a thick part of it, hidden. And then he's going to be up there being my eyes and ears. And I'm going to see through his eyes.
So you turned into Aladdin.
Ooh! We're gonna get sued!
I said Aladdin. How dare you?
Alright, so.
Yes.
He chucks a spear at my illusory devil.
Yep.
The spell description just says that it lasts for the duration. It doesn't say anything about armor class, so I assume the spear would just pass through it.
Okay, yep.
Get down there, buddy.
And I'm gonna try saying in giant. Maybe they speak giant? That seems like a language. Some orcs might know. I'm going to say something. You can't hurt me. Just that. You can't hurt me.
They go charging at your illusory double, the three of them.
That is like... All right. Well, they don't seem to be very friendly. I'm going to switch back to using my own senses and mouth and say that.
Okay.
So, we may have to fight our way across.
That'll be fun.
Yeah. I'm okay with that.
All right, let's do it.
All right. I'm gonna go down first. And it would probably be smartest for you to stay hidden and flank them.
Oh, that's my plan.
All right. Sounds delectable.
I'm gonna switch back to my double real quick. Have they reached him yet? Are they?
Yeah. They're. We'll say they're just about to reach him. Probably within 15 feet.
I'm gonna have him point at one, just one of them, and not say anything, but reach for his weapon.
All right. Are you hoping they'll stop?
I'm hoping they'll see it as a personal challenge.
Make an intimidation check.
That's an 18. I don't have real high intimidation, but I think that'll... Oh, I guess I do. That's 25.
Jesus. The 25, yeah, they all three stop. And the one that you're pointing at points at himself and says,
"You're off little step."
"I don't want to kill you, but I will if I must, and you will die first and the most painfully. Now, do you speak my language?"
He beats his chest twice and says,
"Yes, please."
And takes two steps forward in an attempt to challenge you.
All right, I'm gonna walk over there invisibly and then stand right where that illusory double is and just let that spell drop and pull out my... my rod of lordly might with one hand and a hand axe with the other, and I'm going to hit the button to make that thing a flaming rapier, and yeah, wait for him to
am I able to escort your invisible self down, and then I'll stop.
I don't know how you would do that unless he escorted you down.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, in that, my point was like, can I come down with you to the fight?
Yeah, I guess that would depend on Francis letting you know that he was going down or not.
Yeah, I'll let you know. I'm going over there.
Okay.
I'll say while I'm invisible. There you go.
Then I'll just start going down at a leisurely pace so he can get there before me, but just so that I'm down there.
Yeah. And I'm gonna pop out the flaming rapier from the Rod of Lordly Might, and I'm going to wait for him to make the next move. I don't know what their
custom
is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, let us roll initiative.
17.
How about a 26?
I got 23.
Okay, so Orc 1, the one that you were just pointing at, got an 11.
Nice.
And then Orc 2 and 3 all grouped together with a 7.
Nice.
All right, so I'm in the tree line, correct? Which is how far?
I would say you're 60 feet away. If you didn't go down, you also could have gone down with Francis and Hesh if you wanted. If not, then...
Unless you want to stay hidden.
Yeah, then you're 60 feet.
Yeah, I want to... stay up in the tree. I just want to have like my bow at the ready, watching from the trees.
Okay.
So I can, what kind of weaponry do they have?
They have a scimitar, some darts, and they have a kind of magic rune that is tattooed on them in different places. Always on their deformed extremity. So if one has a deformed leg, the tattoo is huge on its deformed leg. One has it on its arm. One has it on its neck because its head is all tilted and its neck is huge, like it's got a goiter.
Okay, can I...
Weird mutant orcs.
Would it be insight on, like, trying to figure out, like, maybe a coalition between their deformities and the runes?
To see if the runes cause the deformities or...
Or whatever
like
the
rune nature
is.
Check?
Yeah, no, I don't think that would be nature.
Arcana?
It would be Arcana. But probably...
Just keep picking my lowest attribute.
Yeah.
Please.
Well, it's definitely it's a magic, you know, thing that you're looking for. So yeah, roll an Arcana check.
15.
Okay, yeah. So 15 is what you needed. Yeah, the deformities do seem attached to the arcane rune that has been carved, it looks like, into the orc.
Do I know what that... Do I know the rune, I guess?
Nope, you would not know the rune. You might recognize it as one of the ancient elven runes that are put on them from some of the stuff that... like. You know, Tim, when you saw, or was it Terry? Yeah, when you saw Terry in the portal. It's very similar to that, but it's not any of the same. It's not the same rune, but you can kind of tell, like, the way the runes are crafted, that there's a similarity to the other.
Okay, so I would call out to Hesh and Francis and let them know that their runes seem to be attached to the deformities and for one reason or the other, and it seems to be an ancient elven rune.
Calling out lets them know that you're up there, just so you know.
Okay.
So, they have scimitar and darts.
Okay.
In that room. I've got a little bit of reach right
I'm
now.
I'm down for it.
You guys are closer, so... Unless they can fly. Can they fly? I guess that's a question I should ask.
No, also they have wings.
Oh, fuck me. God damn it. But they're like ostriches. They can't really fly, right?
But they're mean as hell.
That's okay. I'm up in a tree.
Okay.
I'd
probably stop about 10 or so feet from Francis's duplicate.
Oh, wait. Real quick. Ayda, you can ready an action.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if you wanted to say, you know, if the orc that Francis challenged rushes at Francis, I want to shoot an arrow at him. And then his action will trigger your action.
Okay.
So if you want to call something like that, I'll let you do that right now before Hesh takes over.
Yeah, I'll just be like, I've got my bow at the ready.
Okay, perfect. And so if he charges, is that what you want to do?
Yeah.
Okay. Hesh.
Yeah, so I stop about 10 feet from Francis' duplicate, which is now Francis. And after she had said that, would find the neck goiter and cast Dispel Magic on it.
On the rune?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have to touch that?
Nope.
Okay,
it's cool. 120 feet range.
Nice.
It's not... concentration, and if it's third level or lower, it's automatically dispelled. Anything higher than fourth level, it's 10 plus the spell level that
okay.
I have to beat.
So it's a fifth level spell, so you need to roll out, what, 12?
I rolled a 19 plus my arcana. Yeah. So it would dispel it.
Yep.
Nice. Nice.
So you dispel this magic. This is not the one that Francis challenged. The one that Francis challenged is the one that has a tattoo on his left arm. Or not a tattoo, a carving on his left arm. And its neck begins to swell to the point where it is huge. And then finally it explodes. And the neck snaps of the orc and it falls to the ground dead.
This concludes this episode of A Fool's Quest. Join us next time for more fun and daring adventure. Thank you for listening, and don't forget to like, subscribe, review, and comment on your favorite platform to listen to A Fool's Quest.
I didn't say you would.
Oh, right, Puddles, that's cool.
She doesn't want a beer either.
She's like, don't do it!
Oh, she's about to do it again. There we go.
It's all the children she's been eating.
And old people.
Yep.
That's what pit bulls
eat. You got
eat.
Another one? There we go.
Hey.
Yeah!
You got a tickle? Go get a drink of water.
Nope. One more? What you got? Oh, a little drool. That's cool.
Thinking about all the old people and kids.
How many arms she chewed off this week?
She burped up one that didn't taste good.
One more. There we go. Come on. You got it. There we are.
Waiting for like a little shoe to come out.
Mm-hmm.